Blackstone Publishing presents Ashes of Onyx, a novel by Seth Skorkowsky. This book is read by Caroline Shaffer. For Jorge Soto, who not only encourages my weirdness, but enables it. Thanks, brother. Chapter 1. Pinhole in a Parade Float. Kate needed a fix. 3 days since her last scrape of dust, and the withdrawals were creeping along the base of her skull like 100 needle-legged fleas. Normally, she could endure it, but sitting and waiting only made the itching worse. Desperate for a distraction, she rose from the leather chair and approached a locked display against the office wall, a modest collection of outer world artifacts proudly rested beneath museum-grade lighting. Careful not to let her breath fog the tempered glass, she leaned closer to inspect a hollet globe, a jeweled orb not much larger than a softball. Etched bands of red and whitish metal wove between the multicolored stones along its surface. She'd seen a half dozen such puzzle spheres before. Albeit smaller, Wegner's was superb in its craftsmanship. It was definitely the crown jewel of this collection. She could get a few $100 for it with a single phone call, more if she had a week to shop it around. But why sell it for cash when she could trade for dust? 2, maybe 3 ounces if she played it right. The other artifacts were quite banal. A Devon gallows mask, a slender ivory ladle cut from the horn of some strange animal, and a bronze ring bearing an angular coat of arms she didn't recognize. None of them were magical that she could detect. But Wegner would be a fool to display magical artifacts near a tempting window, even here on the 19th floor of this Baltimore skyrise. No, Kate decided. These artifacts were here for her. That explained why he was late to this appointment, allowing her time to explore his office alone and see for herself that he truly was a collector. Kate didn't care one way or the other, as long as the money was good. One of the two oaken doors opened, and Claudio Wegner stepped inside, a waft of expensive-smelling cologne swirling in his wake. "I'm sorry to keep you waiting, Miss Rossdale." He extended a hand, the manicured square nails buffed to a high gloss. "No problem at all," Kate said, delivering her lines in this needless play. She accepted the hand, hoping he didn't notice how bad hers were sweating. "I was just admiring your collection." He nodded his thanks. "Please, sit." Kate lowered herself back into one of the two chairs opposite Wegner's desk, its inlaid surface preserved beneath a plate of beveled glass. She scratched the back of her neck, chasing away the imagined fleas. Wegner took his seat. His combed back blonde hair gave an impression of speed, disrupted only by his prominently jutting ears. The strong jaw and deeply cleft chin were something movie stars would envy. His build was that of a former athlete, a softening that still told of the muscles beneath. "I trust you're doing well."
"I am," she lied.
"Good." He gave a hollow businessman's smile, tight-lipped and devoid of warmth. "I've had the opportunity to add to my collection a particular piece of some value, but before I complete the transaction, I want to be sure it's authentic."
"Always pays to be sure."
Kate set her hands across her lap to calm their trembling. It had been 2 months since her last job. She needed money for a fix, and maybe food, worse than she ever had. Money hadn't been an issue at first. She'd had plenty after Master Boyer's death, but time and bad decisions had whittled that away.
"You know my fee?"
"Of course," he said with a smile of very white teeth. Wegner withdrew a stack of crisp $20 bills from his drawer and set it on the desk. $2,000 in advance. We can't have a disappointing answer.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.